Welcome to the clinical examination tutorial series. This is the continuation of the cranial nerve examination. My name is Dr. Brian Benninger. I work at Oregon Health and Sciences University. And we want to continue with cranial nerves 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12, that being the vestibular cochlea, glossopharyngeal, vagus, spinal accessory, and indeed the hypoglossal nerves. Now, to start with the vestibular cochlea, there's two parts to that nerve, the vestibular portion and the cochlea. And the vestibular portion has to deal with balance. So with that, you would ask the patient, or you could have watched them when they walked in, if you had that advantage to see them walk in. If not, you would ask the person to get up, walk a few steps, four or five steps, have them turn and come back. Focusing on the turn. The turn is really quite difficult to execute if you've got some sort of vestibular problems, okay? So focusing on that, that would be the vestibular portion. Now the cochlear portion is for hearing. Now, with that in mind, you don't need elaborate sorts of tests, but you want to be aware that some people can lip read very well if they're compromised and spent years of practicing that. And so what one wants to do is two things. Either gently rub your fingers together and say, tell me when you can feel my fingers rubbing, and you may not rub them, obviously, and to see what they say, or you can lean past their vision, their peripheral vision, whisper something in the ear and ask them to repeat it. So you lean past them, whisper something ever so quietly, come back and say, what did I just say to you? And you might say, Mrs. Brown lives on Main Street, or something of that sort. So you have two options, either using the movement of the fingers, that. Now, two other tests that people often do for bone conduction, okay, is to use a particular tuning fork, the Rennie's test or Weber's sign, which one would hit the tuning fork and either press it on the mastoid process on both sides, and ask them to see when they actually can hear the tuning, or I should say feel the and hear the tuning fork, and indeed when you do the test on the vertex of the head. Now, from there, one moves on to the 9th and 10th cranial nerves are examined together, the glossopharyngeal and the vagus. Now, classically what happens is you ask the person to open their mouth wide. Usually you would use an orange stick or some sort of a utensil that you'd use clinically, and you'd introduce it into the mouth, press on the back of the pharynx, and what you're assessing, and you shine a torch in there, and you're assessing for the gag reflex. Now, one of the things I think is overrated is indeed the gag reflex, because is it terribly important to recognize that? Yes. If one normally has one and they lose that, then that's a terrible problem and can create enormous problems for the patient and for the treating clinician. However, there are people in the population who don't have a gag reflex, and so therefore it's important that we assess that. Now, to be able to pick that up doesn't take a very acute clinician. However, what is terribly important and what you can maximize from doing this examination is actually when you do the gag reflex, watch for the soft palate, the palate in the back there. When you look at it, make sure that during that gag reflex that you watch to see if it, that it lifts or rises symmetrically. At times, what can happen is the right or the left side will lift quite aggressively and the other one will follow behind, and therefore you'll pick up a subtlety that indeed those particular nerves are not working functionally to help that soft palate lift. And so I think the more important part to pick up, you'll notice the gag reflex or the absence thereof immediately. The key is to actually look at that soft palate, okay? So with that in mind, we move on to the 11th cranial nerve, the spinal accessory nerve. Now the spinal accessory nerve, its target organs are the sternocleidomastoid muscle coming from the ear down towards the clavicle and the sternum, and indeed going to the trapezius. So two aspects to this to be comprehensive. Ask the patient to go ahead and elevate their shoulders and then put them down. That would be called a shrug, if you like. And the fact that this particular person can do that tells me muscle-wise on a power scale there's 3 out of 5. Okay. Now I would ask the person to do it again and say, do not let me push your shoulders down. And so I would press fairly gently at first, more aggressive, and then relax knowing that she resisted quite appropriately and therefore 5 out of 5. Now, again, one of the problems I feel when you have quite elderly or people who are, shall we say, very petite, that is to start down low and press on the shoulders and then ask the patient to lift them up. Sometimes can be very awkward and very difficult to do, and also I find very difficult to assess where that power is at. But if you have them lift against gravity, go ahead, and then you say, now don't let me push them down, you can get a feel if one side drops before the other, that sort of thing. So that can be very helpful. Now, the second portion, the sternocleidomastoid, again, I have them turn their head right to left, okay? Sometimes you can ask them to place their ear down towards their shoulder on either side. Now, generally, to examine it against resistance, you place the back of your hand right against their cheek and ask them to turn aggressively that direction, okay, and then you do it on the opposite side, and you're assessing the strength there on the sternocleidomastoid as well as trapezius, okay? Once you've done that, you then move on to the 12th cranial nerve, the hypoglossal nerve. And again, there's an element of technique that you can be fooled by. Now, sometimes you ask the patient to go ahead and stick your tongue out and then leave the mouth closed. Go ahead and stick your tongue out further and leave the mouth closed. Lips around the tongue. Okay, so what can happen is you'll ask a patient to stick their tongue out, and they may do exactly what our patient is doing here, and that is it's protected by the lips, and therefore I'm not seeing any movement of the tongue, and you'd be fooled by that. What you should do is say, please open your mouth, stick your tongue out, and make sure that their mouth is so open that indeed the tongue is not being controlled by the lips themselves. Now you wait about 15 to 30 seconds, which will seem like an eternity, and you watch the tongue either for fasciculation, which is a type of, if you like, just wiggling or jiggling about, or with a bit of time, if it starts to drift to the right or the left. Classically, if it drifts over to the right, we know they have a right-sided lesion affecting that particular hypoglossal nerve, or if it drifts to the left, it's a left-sided lesion. Now, again, it takes a little patience, ask them not to control their tongue with their teeth or their lips, wait a little bit longer than what you might expect. You wouldn't just ask them to stick their tongue out and then say, okay, fine, and they retract it. Have them leave it out for a short while, assess and see what happens. That's being 15, 30, 45 seconds, and look for fasciculation or movement. Again, why do we do that? Because we want to stress the system. If we don't stress the system, we will miss the subtleties. All right, so the take-home message with the modified cranial nerve exam is make sure that you stress the system and don't be afraid to ask a couple of appropriate questions that go with each cranial nerve. Thanks very much.